Well, here we are going to model the formation of the GD1 stellar stream inside the host with the fermionic dark matter core halo distribution, which is the model, the RAR model that Carlos has presented in the previous talk. Well, there are many streams discovered in the last years, thanks to Gaia Data and another service. Here, this is an atlas of most of the stellar streams discovered up to date. Here is lacking the Sagittarius stream, but it is not focus of in this article. But we can see some already well-known streams like GD1, PAL5. Can you see the arrow? PAL5, Ophiuchus, Orphan stream. In this talk we will be interested in GD1. The GD1 stellar stream is a cold stream traveling through the halo, here shown in his self coordinates, which are great circles. Phi1 is an angle that goes along the stream, and Phi2 goes across it. That's why it looks like elongated here in this variables. In this case, Price, Whelan, and Bonaca have made a picture of the stream by cutting in proper motion spaces, and then applying a filter in color magnitude diagram, and they have obtained a very clean picture of the stream, where you can see two condensation of stars off track the stream, which are the spur and the blob, two gaps, at least two gaps, and here the question progenitor, because GD1, that we don't know still where is the progenitor of GD1, if it has been dissolved by the tidal forces of the Milky Way, or if it is hidden there. So we will use the GD1 stream to study a system of self-gravitating fermions that satisfy a maximum entropy production principle, which is the RAR model. Some previous motivations. There has been a fit of the GD1 stream to an axisymmetric dark matter halo, and the result was that the flattening was 0.8, compatible with 1, so it is compatible with the spherical halo, but the maximum was in 0.8. So one motivation is, can we fit the GD1 stream with a spherical halo with the RAR model? And the other motivation is that the RAR model relies on rotation curves, but there is some tension among rotation curves. Here we can see three different rotation curves that they differ. It's true that the rotation curves depend on the velocity of the local standard of rest assumed, but even if we rescale them, they have differences. So the idea is to use the streams to prove the acceleration field. It's an idea that has been in the literature in the last years. So a single objective of this talk, of this work, is to fit the RAR model according to a few observables, which will be shown in the next slide. Our model, our full model, has got 18 parameters, 12 from the potentials and 6 from the initial conditions of the orbit of the stream. The stream will be modeled as the orbit, because I said it is a cold stream. Then we have I have explained where the parameters come from. 8 come from the variance model, 2 from the bulge, and 6 from the thin and thick disk, and 4 parameters come from the RAR model. We have the fermion mass, the degeneracy parameter theta zero, the cutoff energy parameter W0, and the parameter beta zero that is associated with the temperature. Well, but there is, how do we cope with these 18 parameters? Well, there is some a priori knowledge. There are fits to the Sagittarius A star's orbits, which imply that the fermion mass must be higher than 56 kilo electron volts, and that the core mass is approximately 3.5 10 to the 6 solar masses. So in this work, we set the fermion mass to 56 and beta zero to that value in order to have the given core mass. Well, there are also fits made by Pauliasis et al. To the radial surface density profiles and to the vertical density profile at solar radius. These fits take into account observations of the baryonic component. They are not fits to any dark matter model or anything like that. They are basically counting stars. So we are using them to determine the baryonic parameters as done by Pauliasis. And so we are left with only 8 parameters, 2 of the Rohr model and 6 from the initial condition of the orbits. But this will change as we will soon see. Well, the observables. The observables are the position in the sky in these phi1, phi2 coordinates of the stream, the heliocentric velocity, the proper motions in right ascension and in declination. This is the proper motion multiplied by the cosine of the declination. Then the proper motion in declination, and the photometric distance, which was computed with help of apart from the Gaia data, which is used by StreamFinder, it was computed using PanSTARRS data in order to increase the precision. So we don't have access to the individual data here, but we have access to the coefficients of the polynomials that Iwata et al. 2020 fitted to this data. So in our work, our observables are the polynomials fitted by Iwata, which we have access to them. Well, so we define a grid in the domain of Iwata polynomials, phi1. We define a g-square per each datum, which is a sum of the g-squares associated to every coordinate. Phi1, proper phi position in the sky, proper motion in right ascension, in declination, the distance, photometric, and the heliocentric velocity. We compute the total chi squared, and we use a genetic algorithm applied to the full model, but we found bad fits. The optimizer is lost in all the local maximum that has got this high parameter system. So we had an idea, it's to use an alternative solution. It is to use the potential fitted by Malhan et al., the one I shown in previous slides, to find the best fit orbit and use its initial condition as an approximation to our problem. And that worked. And now, because now we have a full model which has got only 2 parameters effectively, and this worked, we found the theta zero approximately 36 and W zero 63. And here we can see the fit of the stream in red, and in blue is the Iwata polynomials, which are our data here. And we also can compare with the solution from the axisymmetric Milky Way potential, and they look very similar. And they have got also similar chi square values. Sorry?
There are five more minutes.
5 more minutes. Okay. Okay, well, then 5 minutes, including the questions, or?
Including the questions.
Ah, okay, okay.
You can use 5 minutes and have people ask you later.
Okay, okay. Thanks. Well, then we have the, here we have the result of feeding in the observable space of the stream. And now we check what happens with the rotation curve. We see that the rotation curve of our feed, which is in red, more or less moves between that rotation curve of the data. The green rotation curve is from the feed from Malham for the axisymmetric dark halo. What I want to point out here is that between 14 and 15.5 kiloparsec, which is the range covered by the observed stream, not the range that the stream travels all around his orbit, because the stream goes from 14 to 25 kiloparsec, but the observed stream goes from, it's only 1.5 kiloparsecs, it goes from 14 to 15.5. Well, that is marked with orange vertical lines, and we see that in that range, both rotation curves of both fitted models agree. That is related with the fact that the streams are good tracers of the acceleration field, so that's why the rotation curves must be similar in both cases. Some important halo features: the radius is 28 kiloparsec and the mass is 1.4 times 10 to the 11 solar masses. So we have a very small and light dark halo compared to other feats in the literature. Well, the conclusions are two. It is possible to model the G1 stream using a dark matter core halo spherical distribution constituted by self-gravitating fermions, and that stellar streams are good traces of the acceleration field. Well, thank you to all of you. I am open to questions if there is time.
We have time maybe for one or two short questions if there are in the audience or in the chat. Remember, if you think of questions later, you can leave them in the Discord server, just in case. I have one very general question. This is a question maybe for Carlos as well, because I don't know much about this, but is fermionic dark matter an alternative to models such as FLB5, or do they work within them? It's a very general question.
Can you repeat alternative to what?
I couldn't. An alternative to such as F of R or F5 or Lambda CDM, or is it a model that works within those paradigms?
No, it's alternative. It's more in the field of warm dark matter.
Okay. Yeah, that answers my question.
Yes. Generally speaking, it can be said that this is an alternative to Lambda CDM in terms that these particle masses are typically included in the Lambda warm dark matter paradigms. But the particle mass here is cold enough in the sense that it's 10 HeV. Therefore, it will produce the same large scale structure formation, because you can check the power spectrum that the suppression starts to arise at very large K, above 10. Therefore, yeah, it's like linear structure formation is the same as cold dark matter, but then the particularities arises in the innermost scales of the halo.
Thank you very much.
Can I say one last thing?
Sure.
In case someone, collaborator or student wants to work in streams, where they are welcome. In particular, for example, spectroscopists are needed to compute radial velocities to make follow-ups of some streams.
Okay. We can thank Martin again. Thank you for the talk.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Bye.
We can move on to lunch now. So, here we go.